Hi, welcome to NDE TV. I'm Pegi Robinson. Today's guest is Wendy Hall, and her son, Jaden, passed away 2 years ago, and she had a shared death experience with him. And she's going to share that with us today. She's never shared it before, so I really appreciate your courage and wanting to share this with everyone. Maybe it'll help somebody. So hi, Wendy.
Hey, Pegi. Pegi, again, thank you for the opportunity to share my experience with your audience and you as well. On July the 19th, 2021, it just started out as a normal day. I was out for spring break. I was out for summer break. I'm a teacher. So I was out for summer break, and my son, he was in summer school. He was in the second part of summer school because they had like an A term and a B term. Well, he did B term, and it was his junior year, and he was trying to make sure that he had all the credits to be a senior that upcoming school year. And see, Ms. Peggy, at this time, I was extremely proud of Jaden because we had went through the rebellious stage, the 15, 16-year-old stage, and I had actually saw my baby. I had actually saw him turn it around. Like he cared about his credits, his school. He was getting up on his own. I didn't have to get him up. So he showed me that he really, really wanted to graduate. And so because of that, you know, of course, I was very supportive and happy to see that. Well, that morning when we got up, I remember him saying, Mama, hurry up. You're going to have me late. And I was like, okay, because I was still kind of sleepy. But I was like, okay. So when we got ready to get in the car, I noticed that Jaden was dressed really nice. Now, you got to understand, like in the summer, teenage boys, they wear like basketball shorts and a t-shirt. But that day he was dressed real nice. He was dressed like it was like a normal school year and a day that he wanted to dress up. And I don't know why I didn't say anything, but in my head, I kept saying, Dad, Jaden look nice. I wonder why he's dressed up. But I didn't say anything. Well, I left as we leaving the house, and I took him to school. Now, keep in mind, his school may be 4 to 5 minutes max from my house. So it's kind of like right around the corner. And so when we got to the school, it was 8:30 on the dot. And so he said, Mama, you can't take me in that way because it's already 8:30. They're not going to let me in. I'd be considered late. So that meant that I had to go around in front of the school, which is like a circular drive. And so now, while I'm driving, headed to Circular Drive, I have one of my girlfriends on the phone. So her and I talking. And then as I go in the driveway, I saw some of my old colleagues. And so they kind of like got my attention. I was, hey, you know, just happy to see them because I hadn't seen them in a long time. Now, at this time, pulling up, I was so busy speaking, and that occupied me. I didn't even say goodbye to Jaden, not knowing that that would be my last time seeing him. Well, he didn't say goodbye either. He was just trying to hurry up and get in the building because the bell had rung. And at that time, there were a lot of kids trying to get in the building. They didn't want to get a late pass. Well, after I dropped him off, you know, went on about my day, maybe about an hour and a half, maybe two, he texts me and he sent me a picture of a graded assignment that he had just gotten back. And he had a B+, and I was so proud of him. And I remember texting him back saying, awesome sauce. And he was like, Mama, I'm not in kindergarten, because that's like the language I use with them because I'm an elementary school teacher. And so I was like, okay, whatever, but that is good. That's good. Well, I was so proud of Jaden. I didn't even go straight home. I went to the store and I bought him so many clothes. Like he's a big fan of Polo Ralph Lauren. And if you know, that's kind of pricey sometimes. But I was so proud of my baby. I bought him a coat, and I bought him so much stuff. And I just know he was going to be like, what, Mama, you bought this? But, you know, I did all that. I put all that stuff in a bag because I just couldn't wait to show him once I picked him up from school. Now, keep in mind, Jaden didn't have a license. He only had a learner permit. So I was solely the person that was responsible for taking him to and from school. Now, there are times his dad would pick him up, but he was working a summer program too out of town. So it was just mostly me. Well, that when I got home, after I purchased all the stuff, I kept it in the car. Because remember, I pick him up, so I wanted to show it to him. When I picked him up, but I got home, did a couple things, and he gets out of school at 1:30. And I remember talking to my youngest, her name is Taylor, and I remember talking back and forth to Taylor. And before I knew it, I lost track of time. And I looked at my watch, it was 1:35. And I said, "Hey, Tay, I gotta go. I gotta go pick up JJ." I said, "I'll be right back." And she was like, "Okay, mama." Now I ran out the back door. When I ran out the back door, I got in the car. When I got in the car, it was something. At that time, I had a Facebook account. And at that time, something had gathered my attention, something that was going on at my church or some kind of comment. But anyway, I looked at it, but I was like, "Oh no, I don't have time right now. I got to go pick Jay up." So I began to start the car. And the moment I began to start the car, I got a bing, the little message that you get from the Facebook Messenger app. And it was Jaden. And when I clicked on it, it said, "Got a ride." And when he said that, I took a deep breath, because you got to understand, I didn't like Jaden riding with his friends because I wasn't sure if they were driving safe. I just didn't know, you know. And so I'm that mama bear. I know he was 17 and I had to give him some room, but when it came to that, I wanted to be the one to, you know, take him wherever he needed to go. And so I just say, I took a deep breath and I text back and I said, "Okay." So I said, "I'm just going to sit here." Cause like I said, it's 4 minutes, 4 to 5 minutes max from the school, from my house to my house. And so I said, "I'm going to just sit here and wait on him." So as I sat there, my phone rung, and it rung through Facebook. And I saw where it said Eric. And Eric is one of my baby's best friends. Jay probably had about, he's going to be so mad with me because I don't remember the number, but it's anywhere between 11 and 13 of them were like a pack. Well, when Eric called me, I didn't think nothing of it. I thought Eric was going to say, "Hey, Miss Wendy, Jaden is with me." But when I answered the phone, he said, "Miss Wendy," he said, "Jaden has been involved in a car accident." And I said, "Is he okay? Is he okay? And he said, "Miss Wendy, it's bad." He said, "The car has crashed and the side that Jaden is on fire." And when he said that, I put my car in reverse. Now, I don't know where I'm going because I don't know exactly where they are. I put my car in reverse, but immediately I lost every piece of strength that I had in my body. So I put the car in park and I jumped out the car and I began screaming. I'm in a driveway. I'm screaming from the top of my lungs. My daughter came out of the back door and she said, "Mama, no." She later told me she said that because she remembered that same scream the night my nephew was killed. So she said she knew it was bad. And I said, "Taylor," they said, "JJ been in an accident. They said that the car is on fire." And so she began screaming and we're trying to call people. Like I called his dad and I called my nephew. Those are the two people I remember calling. And then my daughter was calling everybody else. My other daughter, she was just calling everybody else. So I'm just running, screaming, and like in a circle, running, screaming in a circle. And then my children's father called me and he said, "Wendy, please don't come up here." He said, "Please, whatever you do, don't come up here." And I knew it was horrible. So I dropped the phone. And by this time, I began running from the side of the house to the back of the house, all the way to the left side of the house. And when I got in front of the house, Taylor was already in front of the house. I think she was on the phone with our pastor. And I remember just screaming, jumping. I couldn't control myself. Miss Pegi, I wish I can tell you exactly when it happened. But all of a sudden, I got the urge to sit down. I couldn't stand no more. And when I sat down, I sat on the front porch and I said, "What is this on me?" I just remember doing this. Whatever it is, it felt funny. It wasn't like a stabbing feeling. It wasn't a pinching feeling, but it felt funny to my body. And I was trying to get out of it. Like I was trying to get out of that feeling. And I remember doing that. I did it until I couldn't do it anymore. And all of a sudden I was still. All of a sudden I was still. And what it brought was peace. What it didn't bring on earth is I've never felt this kind of peace in my life before because I couldn't function in it. it brought peace. And I remember just like, I went from screaming to the top of my lungs to just zero. And I remember just sitting there. And Taylor continued to scream. And I think that kind of brought me out a little bit. And I remember saying, Taylor, come and sit down. I said, Taylor, it's a peace all over me. I said, come and sit down. And I remember patting her on the back. And as I was patting her, I said, it's okay. It's okay. I wish I can tell you how long I was wrapped in that peace, but I'm gonna just say a few minutes. And then when the peace left, it ascended. I felt it go straight up. And the moment it went up, I turned to Taylor and I said, JJ, go home. And she said, Mama, what are you talking about? Where's your faith? Why are you saying that? Don't say that. And I said, okay. I had so much peace on me. I couldn't even like act out loud or anything. I just said, okay. And so I'm sitting there. And as I'm sitting there, my friend, she pulls up. Now she told me when she pulled up and she looked at me sitting on the porch, she said it looked like my body was there, but I wasn't there. Like my soul, the inside of me. She said, your body was there, but you weren't there. And so shortly after she came, my sister-in-law came. And my sister-in-law said she didn't know how to get out the truck because she said, I had like an oar around me. And she said she saw peace. And she said, do she know what happened? She said, she can't know what happened, you know, based on what she, how she's looking at me, what she sees. So she said she didn't know how to get out the truck. She said, that's why when I got out the truck, I just sat next to you. Now, still at this time, no one had verbally told us that Jaden had passed. So we're sitting on the porch because we know family and everybody else is at the scene. And so shortly after those two came, I saw a trail of cars like coming towards my street. And my kid's father was the first one. And when I saw his truck doors open, it was three doors open, the two front doors and the back door. Now, I remember I had just had that experience, but for some reason it left me, or I just didn't remember or was thinking about it. When the doors opened, I just knew Jay was getting out of the back seat, because if I can rely on anybody to bring Jaden home, I can rely on his daddy to bring him home. So when the doors opened and I saw my ex-husband walking towards me, me and my daughter got up and I ran to him and I said, Chip, where's Jay? My ex-husband fell to the ground and I fainted. I knew then that I knew verbally that he was gone. Now, Miss Peggy, I didn't even think about this, like that happened, but it wasn't like I thought about that day, the next day or anything. So maybe like a couple weeks passed. I know it was after the burial and everything. And I was laying in the bed and it just hit me. What had happened on that porch? So I ran to Taylor. I said, Taylor, you remember the day that Jay passed and we were on the porch? I said, Taylor, did you feel anything? She said, no, Mama, I didn't feel nothing. I said, Taylor, please tell me, what did you see from your viewpoint? What did you see when you saw me? She said, Mama, I couldn't understand why you were screaming. You went from screaming to nothing. She said, in her exact words, you looked like you were out of this world. She said, it looked like you were out of space. She said, but I said, look, I'll get to Mama later. I'm just trying to see if my brother's okay. Cause you know, she on the phone with everybody. And that's when I explained to Taylor what had happened to me that day. And Miss Peggy, for a long time, I knew what happened and I wanted to tell somebody, but I knew I just couldn't tell anybody, you know, cause I know everybody, when you hadn't experience something yourself, sometimes it's hard for you to believe what someone is telling you. So I thought I knew one or two people I can tell. And when I mentioned it to them, I was getting frustrated because they were saying things like, oh, that was the Holy Spirit. And I was like, no, that was not the Holy Spirit. And then somebody else said, oh, it was your higher self or something. Like, I was like, no, I said, no. That's that. I know what it is, but I guess I needed validation. I needed somebody to tell me what I already knew. And so I saw this guy on one of the YouTube channels. His name is Jacob Cooper. And he had a pre-birth experience. And he left his contact information. And I remember messaging him. And we began to talk on the phone. And I asked him, could I share my experience with him? And he said sure. And I explained it to him. And he said, you know what you had? He said, you had what you call a shared death experience. That was my first time ever hearing the term. He said, just like you share life with someone, you just like you share in your son's life, you share in his death. And I just was like, so relieved that I had a name. I had a name that I can put on what happened to me that day. And even with that, I still needed validation. And I watch your show all the time. And I remember I said, I'm gonna email Miss Pegi and ask her, could I share with her what happened to me that day? And you emailed me back and you said, sure, I would love to hear your experience. And the response that you gave me is the exact thing that I knew what happened. And I was so grateful. And I want to tell you, thank you so much for responding to me, because you were the only person to tell me exactly what I knew happened. Now, I didn't hear anything. I didn't see anything. Everything was feeling. Everything was kinesthetic. But if I can think in my mind, I can tell you, the moment Jaden realized he was out of his body, the moment he realized that he was out of his body, he said, my mama. Because if you know anybody that know me, they know Wendy and her three children. Boys now, so they're part of the bunch, but they know how close I am to my three kids. And the moment Jay realized he was out of his body, he thought about me. And I know that he saw how hysterical and upset I was. And if I can hear Jay say anything, Jay was saying, mama, please don't cry. Mama, please don't cry. I'm okay. I'm right here. And Miss Pegi, that peace that I felt, I don't care what nobody says, that's the peace that surpasses all understanding. That peace that you can't even function, that peace is not made for earth, because I couldn't even function in it. It took control over me. And I just know that he's okay. And that told me that we don't die. That told me, it went against a lot of stuff that I thought was so. That told me, because when everybody was at that crash site, Jaden was on the porch with me. Yeah. He was on the porch with me before anybody verbally told me. I was able to tell JJ gone. And I often, and it's something that you put when you responded back to me, you said, I want you to always try to remember that moment. Always try to remember that moment, because Jaden and the light came to give you comfort. Came to give you comfort before he left to go home. And so I've walked around and I shared this experience with family. And I finally got enough courage to say, hey, I want to be able to share. So I can let some mama, I can let some daddy know that your baby okay. It still don't stop to hurt, because, oh, do I miss him so much. My baby didn't get a chance to graduate. My baby didn't get a chance to go to the prom. During homecoming, I was buying a headstone instead of buying an outfit for homecoming. I was grieving when other people were celebrating their child's senior year. And I just want to tell, you know, any parent, I know your pain, I know your hurt. Losing a child is the worst pain a human being could ever feel. You're living in a world that you don't even know anymore. I fight because I have two daughters that need me. My oldest said, Mama, please fight because we need you. Because I really didn't care anymore. I just wanted to go with my boy, my only son. I love my boy, me Pegi. I got two girls, but them girls knew it was something about that boy. They knew how it was about my son. Yeah. And I know that he's in a perfect peace. And I know one day when it's my time, it's going to be a beautiful reunion. Me and my boy be back together again.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Wow. Wendy, what a blessing to be able to feel him. And I'm sure so many parents, lost children, loved ones, are going to think, why didn't I get that? You know, why didn't I get that gift? Why didn't I feel mine? And we don't know why God chooses us for these miracles. And I use the words, it's like God defies the laws of nature to give these to us.
Yes. Yes, because it's unexplainable. It's inexplainable. It's inexplainable what happened to me. And like you say, a lot of people haven't experienced that, but I just pray that they receive what I'm saying because it happened. It happened. It happened. It happened. That's how I know that we live on. And that feeling that I kept telling you about that was on me, I now know that to be energy. His, you know, his soul energy. I didn't know what to call it at that time, but I now know it to be, you know, energy. And it's a funny feeling to the human body. It's like, it's, I don't know if it's even supposed to be mixed because the energy is inside the body. I don't know, but I just can tell you it was a funny feeling to my body and I was trying to get it off of me. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, because you didn't recognize what it was, but you were still right. Feeling it.
Yes.
And then yes. You felt that peace and you felt him there.
Yes, ma'am.
And then I love that you had that aha moment later, like made you remember that and recognize
it came out of nowhere. It just hit me. And that's when I ran to my daughter and said, Taylor, please, please, please tell me what you saw. Please tell me exactly from your viewpoint, what did you see? And that's when she said, Mama, you were not on earth. She said, you look like you were out of this world. And it just all made sense because no one could tell me that that didn't happen because it did happen. It did. It did happen. That was the saddest day of my life. That was the saddest, saddest day of my life. But I do try to, like I say, I do try to remember that moment because that moment, like I said, was the last time I was with my baby before he went home. Mm-hmm. Like I said, Miss Pegi, he ascended. He did not go backwards. He did not go forward. He did not go sideways. He just went straight up.
Did that coincide with what I assume medical examiner said that he went instantly?
Well, I haven't gotten the strength yet to look at the accident report. But my daughter, when she looked at it, she said she was at peace because it went the way that she thought it did. And you know, Miss Pegi, my daughter had a dream, and in the dream, her and Jaden talked, and he told her, she said, Jay, she said, you were in a car accident. She said, did you hurt? He said, Ty. He said this to my oldest. He said, Ty, he said it was a boom, it was in heaven. He said, I didn't feel anything. He said, I didn't hurt. He said it was nothing. He said, before I knew it, I was in heaven. And my mama and my sister, they were just screaming. They were just praising God. They were just, and I was just sitting there. My mom was like, Wendy, you're not happy. I said, Mama, I already know that's what happened. I already knew that his soul left before, you know. And Miss Pegi, they brought my baby in a body bag. I was never able to see Jaden's face. I wasn't even able to kiss him and say goodbye. We had to put him in a casket that it was a certain kind of casket that could never be opened again. And you know, I often say God knew I had to have that because I, like I'm not mad that I didn't get a chance to see him because he probably knew that that was just too much to see my baby laying in the casket. Yeah, he probably knew that was too much.
Remember him the way you saw him last.
Yeah.
So what happened? He got in the car. Was it his friend that called you? Was he the one that was driving?
No, it wasn't his friend that was driving. He has a friend. Remember I said he had like a whole bunch of friends, anywhere between 11 and 13 of them. Well, the young man that picked my baby up was one of those friends. Now, he wasn't naive. He wasn't even a summer school student. I guess they all just met up after school to talk. Well, I later found out, because when you say car accident, I automatically think somebody maybe ran a red light or somebody hit someone. I later on found out that the young man was driving, was drag racing. I found out that he was racing the other friend. And as they were racing, they was racing down a main street here in the city that I live in. And it had been raining earlier that day. Well, anyway, he lost control of the car. And when he hit the tree or the pole or whatever, the car instantly caught on fire. And the officer told me that he said, I tried to help Jaden. He said, I tried to say Jaden, but Jaden wouldn't say nothing. He said, I tried to get him out the seatbelt, but it was stuck. And so I guess he crawled out the window. And so now not only do I walk around with grieving and losing my baby, I got to go through the process of being in a court system, dealing with someone who my baby loved. He loved his friends. He always said, Mama, you didn't have me a brother. So these are my brothers. And I often say Tristan didn't look out for his brother that day when he chose to race like that in the streets.
And so the other boys crawled out the window?
Yes, from my understanding, he got out through the window. And it was another young boy that he was racing, which was another friend, but he wasn't injured. It's not like his car hit that car. It's like right. Tristan lost control over the car. And so those two young men were charged. They were charged with vehicular homicide. And it's just a sad situation because I always tell my daughter, even if they don't do a day in prison, or let's say they only do a few years, for the rest of their life, they gotta think about the decision that caused the life of their friend.
So quick, and
yeah, it's amazing how someone could be here and so full of life in 1 minute, and then the next minute they're gone. Because my son was such a he was such a happy person. He was so full of life. He was the reason my house was noisy. You know, he was just a, you know, he was just the person that was the fun person. You know, everybody would be like, where's Jay? Where's Jay? Where's Jay? You know, I miss him every day. Every day. Some days I think I'm the saddest person in the world. Some days I think I am the saddest person in the world. But I often think about my girls, and I think about if I chose to leave, how they would grieve me right now. So I just ask God to help me every day to push forward so I can be here for them and my grandsons.
Just keep remembering that beautiful hug or the time there in the light, or well, I don't know how to word it for you, however you word it, you know, mm-hmm. that on the porch, and to have that. No, he's there beside you, and he was okay, and he was able to let you feel that for a moment.
Oh, yeah. I never forget that feeling. When I tell you, never, ever. And you know what gets me sometimes when I listen to near-death experience? Everybody that talk about that peace, they talk about it out of their bodies. But I felt it while I was in my body. They always say, oh, I left my body and I felt this peace. But I didn't, I was here. I mean, I was in my body and I felt that peace. And I've never heard anyone say that. They always say they have left their body and they felt this peace and this love, but I didn't leave my body. I felt it just, you know, here in the flesh, you know.
I know it probably doesn't mean, you know, much to you, but it's, I find it ironic that in this, that Jake Cooper and I, we met at an IONS conference. We were both being speakers on the same NDE panel. Yeah, he's from New York. I'm from Long Bottom, Ohio, completely different worlds. And I'm a grandma and he's this young guy from New York. And the night before we were to be on the NDE panel, I had went down, my husband with me, to look at the stage because I'd never been on the stage and spoke before. And I ran into Jacob. He was doing the exact same thing I was, checking out the stage the night before. And so we chit-chatted, we just bonded. And then so we're on the NDE panel at the same time. And we become friends ever since. And I lost touch with him about a year ago. But it's so weird that, you know, that Jake ended up being a comfort for you. And then, you know, I talked to you and it just seems like divinely orchestrated somehow.
Yeah. Yeah. Because you too, I'm telling you, I couldn't get answers from anyone. I couldn't go to, you know, people say, well, go to your pastor, go to this person. But like I say, if you haven't had that experience and if you're not an open person, they really couldn't. I don't know how they can help you if they don't, you know what I'm saying? If you don't understand, you know, that's just like losing a child. Like how can a person, or what can a person who's not lost a child say to me? They can say, you know, I'm sorry for your loss, but to say I know your pain would be too far-fetched because unless you actually lost a child, you wouldn't know. I don't wish that on anyone. Like I know, and I'm not dumbing down anybody's grief. Don't get me wrong. Grief is grief and it hurt. But to lose a child, it's no words. All I say is the worst pain a human being could ever feel. And I've never felt, and his daddy often tell me this too, we've never felt so helpless. You know, because as a parent, you usually can do something. Like, oh, I can call someone, or I can go take care of this. We couldn't do nothing but lay there in devastation. And it was like, it wasn't even 10 minutes after I fainted and they brought me in the house. All kind of people coming in the house, like superintendents and principals and school board, because they had, you know, gotten back that they had lost a student, and they were coming to offer their condolences. But I was devastated. I didn't want to hear, I'm sorry for your loss. I lost my child. Like I just, how I supposed to live, what I do, you know? So I was in that state, and don't get me wrong, I appreciate them doing that, but I was just in a state at that point in my life where I was just trying to breathe. I couldn't even breathe. Like they had to call the paramedics and everything. You know, I always, and my oldest would tell you this, I always say, hey, Ty, this is what I want you to do. So when I die, when I go home, I want you to do this, pay off the house, do this, do that. And I always told her to make sure you buy your house and you have my boy a room, have him somewhere to stay. Because I always felt like he was going to be the one that it took him a little longer to get it together than the girls. But I always told them how to bury me. I always told them how to bury me and what to do. And I said, I make sure you guys are fine. You guys, as long as you do right by the money and do everything, you guys should be okay. I've always told them, but Miss Pegi, I know that you can't plan nothing. You know nothing. All you can do is live and take it one day at a time. Because I never knew that I would be burying a child. And you could have never told me that. I always felt like I always knew that I was just, you know, because you're the mama, or, you know, you think, well, I go before my kid, you know. But I never thought I'd be able to bear. I would be burying one of them.
You're always going to miss him. You're always going to want him. Yeah. You're never going to forget him. The hurt's always going to be there. And it will, you know, you've been through this for 2 years and this is going to be your life. This is how Like we carried him in our womb, and now we carry him in our pain and our heart.
It's like happiness and sadness is mixed up together. I don't care what kind of event we have. I don't care what it is. I could be looking at a basketball goal and I'd be like, oh, Jay loves playing basketball. It seemed like in anything I see, do, it's just it's just he's there, he's on my mind. And and my daughter just had a baby. Well, he's a year old. And my son, we call my son Jay. And his first name is Jaden. We always called him Jay. And she named him Kobe Jay. And that just, that did something to my heart. And he won't respond to Kobe. You have to say Kobe Jay, and then he'll turn and respond to you. So, we try to, when we went to Disney World, we had like Jay on our sleeves. And anything we do, we always try to incorporate him because, death can't take away my memories. Him not being that cannot take away my memories. And it's my job to always keep his memory alive. And the light that I try to find in all of this darkness, whenever I'm around young boys, and especially if it's young boys who drive in like these fast cars, these Chargers and Chandlers and Hellcats and all these different cars, Peg, it's like it's on my heart to go talk to them. And I do, I talk to them and I show them a picture of my son and I explain to them everything that happened, and they always receive what I say. Now, it's been one or two where a guy said, oh, okay. And then he still just pulled off speeding. But like my mama said, you did what you were supposed to do. You did, you shared with him how important it is to be careful and how important it is to think about choices that you make in life, because just as quick, your life, your family life, everybody's life can change.
Yesterday, walked out of Sam's Club and it was raining hard. So my husband went to get the truck and I stayed here with the cart. And there's a bunch of other people with their carts and cars pulling in these side things because it was raining. And I noticed this young mother with her cart full of stuff, but she's on her phone and she's got a little toddler. And I'm going to say he's probably 3 years old. And he was standing at the very edge. I don't want to say the curb, there's no curb because that's where cars pull, but see, like he was on the line. And so the mom's like, don't go any further, don't go any further. I'm like, I'm not comfortable with him even being right there. And he was like 16 feet from her. And it's bugging me. So I'm keeping an eye on him. And I see my husband come. So I took my eye off him for a second to tell my husband, you stop right there and I'll just bring my cart over. And just when I look back, that little boy was walking out in the street. Now, mind you, it's raining, it's gray out. She's clear over by the building, even farther away from him now. And he's just walking out through. And these cars are coming around my husband, they're coming around these other cars because it's making us crowded, congested. And I couldn't get the words out fast enough. And I instinctively started clapping my hands real loud. Baby boy in the street, baby boy in the street, screaming, screaming, because I couldn't move. I was just clapping real loud. And what happened was, is these ladies that were putting their stuff in the back of their vehicle, turned to look and see me screaming and pointing. And they looked and they're like 5 feet from him. And they run out and they grab him. Then here comes the mother. And I said, I'm sorry, I couldn't run and get him. I couldn't get the words out or, and she just kind of laughs and they go on. And it's just
Really?
like how fast things can happen.
That fast. And that's why now in life, nothing distracts me enough to do anything. You remember how I said I was too busy speaking to my coworkers and on the phone so I couldn't say, hey, Jay, I mean, see you later, Jay, have a good day. I mean, nothing in this life will ever distract me like that again. A phone call, late for work, whatever. It is what it is. If my kids are there now, when my girls are in the car, I don't talk to anyone. If somebody call, hey, I'm riding with the girls. Hey, I got the grandbaby. I'm learning to put what's important, what's really, really important. And being on the phone and not paying attention to my baby, I promise you, it ain't that important. It can wait.
You know, I think back and I'm now mad at myself because when I seen this was going to happen, you know, it could happen. Not that it's going to, but it could easily happen. I should have, when I first seen this situation, I should have said, excuse me, ma'am, put that phone up. Keep that boy right beside you. He's going to dark out. I should have been willing to be the bad person.
Right.
But you know, you don't want to be rude.
Right.
You don't want to cause a problem.
Right.
But. And it wasn't my job to go over there and hold his hand either or tell him to get back over there with his mother.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm thinking in hindsight, I should have been a little rude. And so maybe I could have worded it like, I'm sorry, this is making me so nervous. Do you mind holding on to him?
Exactly.
I'm just so scared. Because I have done that before with babies standing up in carts in the store. And I'm like, they're going to fall over and hit their head. And I have just done it that way. Instead of like, watch your damn kid, you know, I'm like,
right.
I'm sorry, it's making me so nervous. Would you ask that baby to sit down? You know, she can say it in a nice way.
Mm-hmm.
Parents get distracted and they,
and
sometimes we outsiders see things that they don't.
But you know what, even if being rude sometimes to save a life or get a point across, your intentions are well, you know, you're not being rude just to be rude. You're just trying to, you know what I'm saying? Get the person's attention. I totally understand. Yeah, I totally, you know, I do. And if I have to make someone feel uncomfortable, you know, and say, hey, you know, driving like that is, you know, you can injure someone else's life, your life, you can, you know, and it, even like I say, one time this one guy was just like, oh, okay. But hey, I had to tell him because he was weaving in and out of traffic. And somehow we land up right next to each other. And I felt like that was my opportunity to, you know, to say what I needed to say to him. But when he pulled off, I was just like, I was okay because I did what I knew I was supposed to do.
You know, some people go on and, you know, like have a situation like you and, you know, start talking to schools, especially at the end of the school year when everybody's getting excited, the weather's nice and they're excited, you know, the end of school and all those moments. And did to just, this is what happened.
And you know, it's amazing. It's amazing that you said that because it was like a day or two after Jay had passed. I remember getting up, going to the restroom. I had a vision, just a vision in my head. And I was standing in an auditorium and it was teenagers. It was like a huge auditorium with like anywhere from like 15 to 18 year olds. And I was sharing my story because sharing the story of the loss of my son and the loss of my nephew, because before my baby passed, a year and a half before my baby passed, my firstborn nephew was killed the same way.
Oh my goodness.
The exact same way. My brother, firstborn child. And we just went through trial. Those boys were drag racing and drunk and high and lost control of the car. My nephew was a tiny something. He probably weighed 120. They said when the impact hit my nephew, he was on his motorcycle. It hit him here, but his body was way down the street. And people know me. They know me for the loss of my nephew. And they know just a year and a half later, my baby died the same way. And you know, Miss Peggy, I got angry with my son in his death one time when he was dating a little girl, and she decided, her and her mom decided to talk to the DA because she shared with her mom that one day they were in the car together, her and my baby, and the same young man that was driving was doing the same thing, and they almost hit a tree. And she got out the car. She was like, I'm not getting back in the car with him anymore. She got out the car. My baby got out the car with her. And she called her mom. Her mama said for the life of her, she would not tell her what happened. But the day that my baby was killed, she told her. Mama, that happened to me when I was in that car. So her and her mom went to the DA. And they shared with the DA what had happened. She also had videos of the same young man driving, doing donuts in the street, driving crazy. And that mama told me in the video, my son was in the front seat enjoying the ride. I got angry, Miss Peggy. I got angry because he knew how my nephew was killed and he knew better. Yes, I was so angry. My ex-husband said for the longest, he was angry for a long time. He said he would walk around and say, Jay, why did you get in that car? Why did you get in that car? He said he would say that so much till one day he heard Jay say, Dad, I didn't know. He said he stopped in his tracks and he said, from that moment, he asked God to help him let that anger go. And that was my first time because I couldn't understand how he was angry. But when I heard about that video that was submitted to the DA and I heard that he was in that car, I was so angry with Jaden because he knew if those boys was driving like that, he shouldn't have been in the car with them.
He made a mistake.
Yeah.
Made a mistake.
And I think a lot of times young kids feel like, oh, we did it before, nothing happened. Hey, we got by this time, we can do it again. But you just never, ever, ever know. It may just be that one time. And for my baby, it was just that one time.
Kids make mistakes.
Oh, yeah.
I told this a few times. I was told again the other day on my show. I had a young coworker, 20 years old, and I would just look at him someday and think, he is the just best kid. He's so kind and friendly, not like a lot of his tattooed coworkers and, that we see on the pipeline. I was working with my husband's pipeline at the time. And I would just look at this guy's name's Mitch and just think, he's just goodness. I would just catch myself looking at him. Well, one day he just started approaching me. He had a problem. He had had a wreck, and he was, had to go to court, leaving the scene of an accident. And he left because he had been drinking and things like that. And so I told him about how, you get a lawyer and you do this and that. And so this went on for a few weeks. And this one morning he was so happy. And he couldn't wait to tell me his lawyer just handled everything in court. He's still at work and he had to go. And everything's fine. Everything's taken care of. And he was just so happy. And I was happy for him. Then later in the day, almost quitting time, his mood shifted again. He looked like he was back in his depressed state. And I had been getting these little psychic things about him. Like when he had come talk to me, like his voice was saying, he's suicidal. Be easy on him. Don't be too harsh. Because, my harsh mama comes up, and I was like, he's very sensitive. Be careful. And so here it is 4:30, and he seems real depressed again. And this tattooed coworker of his is being all rowdy. And I just kind of like giving the boys a little lecture and went on. The next day we found out he killed himself at midnight. And the tattooed friend is the one that told us, and I like he didn't care. And I told my husband, take me back to where I saw him last the morning before, where he was so happy. And I don't know why. I just want to feel him, his presence there when he was happy. And so the other guys are over off away from me in the field and the road, to get more information that's coming in about what exactly happened. And I'm by myself in the field, and I'm kind of talking to him, almost like in a prayer, like, Mitch, why did you do this? And all of a sudden I saw him, and he was hovering over me, and he shrugged and smiled and said, I messed up. And that's why I said that to you. He made a mistake. He just smiles and says, I messed up. And later I was able to tell his mom, because we went to the funeral and talked to the family and stuff. I told his uncle and his mom, and they're like, what? And they looked at me, and I just had the feeling that somehow they knew I was telling the truth, like that would be typical of Mitch. And I see his mom's Facebook. I mean, the woman was just, it was her only child. And they were so close, and it was a very close family. And the funeral was so hard. And, but yeah, I mean, we mess up. I look at things I did, I could have caused my death intentionally or unintentionally. And, we're still here. And others make this one mistake and I'm gone forever.
Was he happy? Did he seem it's
Yeah,
not
he was
me, right?
happy. He was at peace. He was just shrugged his shoulders. I messed
I
up.
messed up,
There was no guilt in it. There was no remorse in it. It was just like peaceful. I messed up.
I that was something that I wanted to know that day. I asked my son's friends. I was like, was he happy? Like what how was he? And they was like, he was really happy that day. But one of his friends said, He said they were all talking. That right before Jay got in the car, he said they were all talking. And he said, Jay turned to him and said, well, what you going to do when I die? He said, what are you going to do when I leave? And he said, he just kind of laughed it off. He said, because he's never talked like that or never said anything. And I said, really? He said that? I said, yeah. He said, what you going to do when I die? And I was like, you know, I was, you know, just shocked to hear that. But I was just happy to hear that he was happy. And, you know, I can honestly say the principal at that school that senior year, he included me in everything. He included me in senior day. They gave me a plaque. The school actually voted my son homecoming king. So he got a chance to be at the prom. They had a real big picture. And, you know, of course, you know, they not homecoming. I'm sorry, prom king. You know, they always have a prom queen and king. And they voted him prom king. And we were there to accept the crown. And we had a real big picture. And like the whole school, like they turned off the lights and they had all the flashlights from their phone. And they just, when I tell you, they went out for him. I will be forever grateful for that. Forever grateful for that, because it made him a part of prom. And that's something I always say, my baby never know what it feels like to be at prom. But they made sure that Jaden was a part of prom.
There's so much beauty in tragedy sometimes.
Yeah, it is.
Isn't that strange?
Yeah.
It's like the grace of God through people, through experience, like shared death experience, through just, you know, so much of what you're telling me. It's like, was there beauty in this horrible tragedy?
Yes.
There is.
It is. It is.
And that vision you had, I don't want to put pressure on you, but that vision, it seems like maybe there's a purpose.
It is. I know it. Now, I always tell my daughter, Taylor, I said, Taylor, I didn't have that vision for no reason. I said, it's the reason I saw that. And she said, Mama, she said, you are doing it. I can honestly say you are doing it. She said, you hadn't got to that part of it, that setting where you're in an auditorium. She said, but I see you talking to people. I see you go up and talk to young men. And I remember one young guy, he told me the truth. He had a nice charger. I said, baby, I said, do you race? He said, yes, ma'am, sometimes. And I said, can I share with you what happened to my son? And he said, yes, ma'am. Before I can finish talking to that young man, that boy grabbed me and he hugged me so tight. And he told me, thank you. He said, thank you for talking to me. So I hope just even that conversation, he chooses to never, you know, I told him, I said, I don't care if someone comes beside you and they roll up their engine or, you know, whatever they do to make you race. I said, always think about my face. I said, always think about my baby. I said, he was 17. My baby had only been 17 for 3 weeks. He didn't even live a month after his birthday. And I said, always think about that. But that young man, I can tell that it really, really touched him.
I could see your talk being called Race to Death.
I received that, Race to Death.
They were racing and, you know, like in a hurry to die, you know, like Race to Death. That may be a catchphrase that helped them realize you want to race, maybe you're racing to your own death.
To your death, yeah. Okay, thank you. Definitely write that down, Race to Death.
If you come up with a talk that you would like to give to put out there, I'd be happy mm-hmm. to put it on the channel.
Okay, thank you, okay. I know, and I always pray and say, God, please open that door. Tell me, show me my purpose. There's got to be some kind of purpose in all this pain. And I know that is the purpose. And not just, you know, boys, you have some girls that race. You have some girls that live on the edge, you know, and do types of things like that. And I want to be able to, you know, if I can just say somebody, if I can say some mama, some daddy from just,
my oldest granddaughter, Gia. Well, I have a granddaughter that is a little older, but she's my oldest biological, and mm-hmm. she just got her driver's license, just got her car, just went in her senior year, And I'm going to send this video to her. And I'm going to say, share this with your friends.
Okay. Well, thank you. And I hope it's, you know, I hope it's something I say to let them know that this is real. And that at any time it can happen to anyone. Because you could have never told me in my life that this would have happened to me twice. Two times around. You know, I look at my brother sometimes and now I know the hurt that he walks in. I know the hurt that he walks in, you know, and like I said, it's the worst pain a human being can feel. And
I just imagine Jaden patting you on the shoulder right now saying, good job, mom, good job.
You know, he would always tell me, he always liked rapping. He would always tell me, mama, you're going to be my manager. He was like, you're going to be my manager. And I was like, Jay is going to make me be a manager. He's going to make me get out there and talk. And he would always say, and I would say, why do you want me to be your manager? He was like, because you're smart, mama. You're smart. You know what to say and do. He would always tell me that.
It'd be nice if a rapper could hear this and make a rapping song out of, and make it a, what you would like to do with the talk.
Yes.
You know, in an auditorium. Because, yeah, I'm not gifted like that. But, you know, some people are, to tell his story and put it into a rap and just to reach more people. I mean, all we can do is try to make this world a better place with all the grief and all the burdens and, you know, all the hurt and tragedy, everything we've been through. The only thing, at the end of the day, we can do is try to take those pieces of some artistic talent within us somewhere and through our heart and pain and turn it into something beautiful to help other people that's here to prevent it from happening to other people. You know, we can just try.
Absolutely.
So I appreciate you coming on. Is there any last words you want to say or anything you didn't get to share?
I just want to say, you know, to any parent that lost a child, to know that, you know, your baby's okay and it's going to just be a glorious time. We're going to see them again. I know that. I know that. I know my baby's not in that cemetery. My baby ascended. He went home just like your baby went home. And know that you're going to see your babe again. I know that. I know that. I know that we don't die. Our body does, but we, our soul, our true self, we live on. And we'll be together again. God wouldn't give us such a love not for it to be just over with like that. We serve too much of a loving God for that to happen. And I know, and I'm just so sorry for your loss. And just anybody that grieving the loss of anyone, we'll be together again. That's what I hold on to.
That we can't get these messages in our churches to where people are at that need to hear them, because, you know, they say, oh, this is the devil, you know, NDEs or this or that. But it's just so sad.
That is so true. That is so true. And it's like no one wants to talk about that, but death is a part of life and it's going to hit every one of us. And it's different when you're sitting on the front row. It's different when you're there and you're the immediate family. And we're all going to need that reassurance. We're going to need something to help us move on every day. I don't care about a big old house. I don't care about millions of dollars. I know we need that stuff to live, but the word tells us that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. That stuff is going to be here. That stuff is going to be here. What's important is loving each other, helping one another, and being able to comfort one another. And you're right. I was so happy to hear that in medical school, they now have a course that addresses NDEs. So now a doctor won't just write off what happened to you or say, oh, it was medicine or whatever. They now have a course to help address a person who comes back and say, hey, I was with God, or hey, I saw so-and-so, you know. And I said, the place that is missing is church. That's the last place that is missing is church.
Yeah.
That's it. Yeah. That's the last place that is missing.
And the church and the pastors, ministers, priests that are telling their congregation that this is a devil need run out of there.
Really? Absolutely.
Because it is not the devil.
It is not the devil.
This is God.
It is. It is. It is. And Pegi, I was such a Bible Don't get me wrong. I believe in God. I believe that there's a God. And I believe in the word. I don't believe that everything in the word is meant for this earthly realm. Now, I don't believe that part. But I used to be the person, if the Bible didn't say it, it wasn't true. But oh no. Oh no. Things have really, really changed based on just listening to others' NDEs and my own experience. Baby, little do we know. Little
And
do.
I don't care if they call it universal consciousness or the source or whatever they want to call it. We call it God.
We call it
It's the
God.
same thing.
Same thing. Same thing. And I understand now why people call it universe, because you know one thing, and it's and I would have never known this. You know one thing that gave me comfort during like those first couple months, to sit in the front yard and to look at the trees, just to be in nature. But God is nature. God
Yes.
is everything. So it all made sense
Yeah.
to me.
Yeah. You
Yeah.
touch the tree, you smell the flower, you look at the tree.
Flowers.
It's all God. I
It's
tell
all.
you, when I realized that the most, a few years ago, we went to Sedona. We went to, I want to say Old Man's Cave. That's not it. That's Ohio. Grand Canyon. I looked at Grand Canyon and I looked at all that rock and this is God.
Oh,
I'm looking at God.
yeah.
God is this rock. God is this guy. God is this, God is you and God is me. And I am not God and you are not God, but I'm not that. But I'm just saying it's everywhere. And I was, and the school, how they treated you so beautiful. That was God coming through them.
Oh,
That's what I
yeah.
mean. But they say that this is God. I mean, we have angels among us. That are, God's working through them. God might have been working through me, noticing that little boy right there. I couldn't take my eyes off of him. And the moment I did, he's walking out in the street, and I'm like, ah! And I know people say they're angry. Where was God when my son was killed? Where was God when my wife was killed? Where was God then? To take him home.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Prepared a mansion for all of us.
Oh yeah. And
And all
because
they got to do was listen to stories like this and all the other NDEs and all the other after death communications and shared experience, all these things, there's we're showing you God.
Oh yeah. Oh
And
yeah.
you got to see that and feel it where he
I
was
got you.
going.
Yes, ma'am. I did. I got the opportunity to feel that. I never forget it. I often just sit up and think about it. I just often sit up and just think about it. That is an unexplainable peace. That is an unexplainable peace. That is not an earthly peace. That's the only way I know how to explain it, because it's you can't feel it here. I don't think it's nothing that can make you feel like that here. That's how I know, that my baby was, he was with God.
You
Yes.
see him again. I
Oh
lost
yeah.
twins. I was only 2 months pregnant. They weren't 17, but love is love.
Love is
And the
love.
wanting doesn't stop.
It
You
don't.
always want your son in your arms. I always want my babies in my arms, and one day they will be.
Oh yeah. But a glorious time when that day comes. You're absolutely right.
That's reason to celebrate.
Oh
Well,
yeah.
thank you, Wendy. It's so nice meeting you. I hope you keep in touch.
Okay. And thank you too, Miss Peggy. I humbly appreciate it. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. I'll
All
send
right.
this to you later today, okay?
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Bye.